Hi, my name is Dawn Kasmar, and I'm a PhD candidate in English at the University of Michigan and an intern at ProQuest Alexander Street. My scholarly work focuses on 1580 to 1833 British literature, colonialism, and disability history. This webinar will give a brief overview of comic studies. I will cover what comic studies is, what kinds of scholars engage in comic studies, academic organizations where you can research comics, some of the basic overarching questions taken up by comic studies, and lastly, I will discuss how scholars have used Archie Comics in their research. Many different narrative genres can be found in comic books. The Alexander Street Underground and Independent Comics Database, for instance, contains many comic books that are the familiar genre of action, adventure, and superhero stories, but the collection also includes autobiographical, historical, science fiction, religious, and political comic books. There are also different types of comic books. Comic studies scholars study and research mainstream comic books, independent comic books, graphic novels, manga, and comic book movie adaptations. This slide features three comic book types and genres from Alexander Street: Che, a graphic biography by Manuel Rodriguez; The Real Cost of Prisons Comics, a political comic by Lois Ahrens; and Sirocco, a Japanese manga by Takayuki Fujimura. Comic studies has become increasingly popular in the past 20 years, and comic studies scholars from various different departments, including history, American studies, English, communication, women and gender studies, cultural studies, and newer departments devoted specifically to comic studies. Comic studies is also sometimes referred to as sequential art studies or graphic narrative studies. Because of the deeply interdisciplinary nature of comic studies, many universities also host forums, workshops, organizations, and conferences that allow comic studies scholars across departments to meet and discuss their work and new scholarship. These include the International Comic Arts Forum, the International Bande Dessinée Conference, the Sequential Art Studies Conference, the Conference on Comics and Graphic Novels, Michigan State University Comics Forum, and the University of Michigan Rackham Interdisciplinary Workshop on Transnational Comic Studies. Comic studies is unique because it brings together so many different types of research: literary studies, cultural studies, image and visual studies, just to name a few. Comics are a multimodal literary and art form that requires analyzing the complex relationship between text and image. Unlike most traditional literary forms, comics also rely on visual rhetorics and storytelling. When I have taught courses using comics, we start the semester by developing this multimodal literacy. In other words, reading comics isn't necessarily intuitive. Just like any other form of literacy, it follows rules and norms that helps readers follow panels, texts, and images. Comic studies also draws from cultural studies, a field that investigates the ways in which cultural practices function within systems of power. Popular media, such as comic books and graphic narratives, are just as important to modern storytelling as traditional art and literary forms. Cultural studies examines how social phenomena and popular media operate in relation to ideology, class structures, race and ethnicity, sexual and gender orientation, and national formations. As cultural productions that require multimodal analytic methods, comics are deeply rich objects of study to understand larger social and political structures. Although most comic studies scholars are housed in different departments, comic studies has become increasingly popular, and several universities now have specific departments devoted to comic studies. You can find articles on comic studies research in peer-reviewed journals dedicated to contemporary literature and cultural studies, as well as journals that publish specifically on comic studies. In the remainder of this webinar, I'll be covering some overarching research questions that scholars address in comic studies. The topics I'll cover are by no means exhaustive. In the courses I have taught, students have used comics to research topics as vast as representations of race in popular media, gender and mentorship, employment, US politics and race, the Vietnam War, and cultural constructions of abnormality and the exotic in the history of American freak shows. I will then talk more specifically about scholarship on Archie Comics, especially as it regards LGBTQIA issues. One major research topic in comic studies is, what can this medium do that other forms, such as the novel, can't? Many scholars have looked at the way graphic narratives utilize the form to move back and forth between the present and the past to depict the personal experience of a major historical event. Sarah Henze, in her article, A Necessary Antidote, Graphic Novels, Comics, and Indigenous Writing, argues that the graphic narrative form provides an intervention to colonialist histories of Indigenous Americans. Comic and graphic narrative forms are important to these interventions because, quote, firstly, through the use of these images, the effect that words alone may convey is reinforced, rendering the story of the past as vivid and quasi-immediate as that of the present. Facial expressions, landscapes, sound effects, captions, dialogue, points of view, sequences, body language, and relationships all contribute to making the narrative more real, believable, perhaps even less fictitious. And secondly, images speak beyond linguistic, cultural, and generational gaps, an element that is becoming increasingly important given those gaps caused by shame, lack of education, and more importantly, governmental assimilation policies. End quote. Comic and graphic narratives are accessible forms of history and storytelling, and it is this accessibility that gives them such revolutionary potential. Henze argues that alternative, subversive forms of storytelling like the comic book are a necessary antidote to the conventional and colonialist history of the Americas. Quote, these types of productions, or rather interventions, call for a necessary change in worldview, a reflection on the direct link to a past of colonialism and the undeniable connection to a contemporaneity of imperialism, end quote. This image from Fred Van Lent's comic book history depicts how page layout can be used as a narrative tool as well. Like text, graphic narrative pages are read from left to right, top to bottom. The smaller panel in the upper left is the first moment depicted on this page, showing the character traveling to the big city, and it provides a more intimate window. The larger dominant image on the page zooms out to show the character's moment of arrival to the city. The focus is not the character, but rather what the character sees. Another question comic scholars pose in their research is, what is the impact of the way comics and graphic narratives represent people of color, women, or LGBT issues? For instance, Mark Singer explains, quote, comics rely on visually codified representations in which characters are continually reduced to their appearances. This system of visual typology combines with the superhero genre's long history of excluding, trivializing, or tokenizing minorities to create numerous minority superheroes who are marked purely for their race. Black Lightning, Black Panther, and so forth. Yet in recent years, some comic creators have demonstrated that the superhero genre's own conventions can invite a more nuanced depiction of minority identity, end quote. Although comics rely on visually codified representations, the various methods and forms available to graphic narrative also invite nuance. For instance, in his article, Singer looks at the way comics like Black Lightning and Zero portray double consciousness. Past and current research on Archie Comics falls into a few categories. Overarching research themes are textual and character analysis, the use of Archie Comics in the classroom instruction and literacy, comics and Cold War culture, teen issues and representations of teens, and sexuality and gender. Scholars like Bart Beatty have focused primarily on textual analysis in articles like Modernism and Riverdale, reading the self-evident text ambiguously, and in his monograph, 12 Cent Archive. Peggy Dickinson, Robin Danzak, and Brian Patrick Burke have done research on the use of comics, and Archie Comics in particular, as an instructional tool for literacy development for teens and young adults. Bonnie Norton has done extensive research on this topic as well, including research on comic book culture for second language learners. The accessibility of comic books, with the aid of additional visual cues such as page layout and images, functions to help reader comprehension and engagement. Raphael York and Quincy Marlin Young have both published research on representations of the Cold War in graphic narrative and in Archie Comics in particular. Although comics often have a more lighthearted narrative tone that, on the surface, may seem incompatible with serious study, it is precisely Archie's casualness that make it a rich resource for understanding how issues like the Cold War penetrate so many areas of everyday life. For instance, Gene Gardner looks at the rise of romance comics and storylines such as are frequently seen in comics like Archie. Gardner writes, quote, "In romance comic stories of the early 1950s, the negotiation of a girl's independence and maturity frequently took place in a sexual context and nearly as frequently involved a question of class status," end quote. The characters of Archie navigate this process of independence and maturity via romantic encounters of, quote, going steady against the backdrop of the Cold War. As Beth Bailey has argued, the practice of 1950s teenagers going steady is a sort of play marriage, a mimicry of the actual marriage of their slightly older peers. The stability of these play marriages helped counter the anxieties of the Cold War and the threat of nuclear war. Archie Comics have also been an important site of research for LGBT studies. As Jeffrey P. Dennis notes, at first glance, the Archie comics appear consistently to present a raucous, aggressive, heterosexual practice as natural, universal, and eminently more important than other pursuits or interests. This is what Michael Warner termed heteronormativity, the, quote, practice of organizing patterns of thought, basic awareness, and raw beliefs around the presumption of universal heterosexual desire, end quote. While heterosexuality refers to the desire of persons of different sex, heteronormativity functions to deny the valid existence of same-sex desire from what can be displayed, discussed, or even conceived, end quote. After the establishment of the Comics Code in the 1950s that functioned to censor, among other things, sex perversion or any inference to the same, Archie characters became especially invested in heterosexual practices and competition. Despite the necessity of proving their heterosexuality and disavowing any such suggestion of queerness, Dennis locates queer spaces in Archie comics by identifying three major textual anomalies that can suggest the presence of same-sex desire. These anomalies are plots driven by a character's desire to meet, maintain a relationship with, or rescue someone of the same sex, interactions between characters of the same sex that use gestures, body placement, or vocal cues usually restricted to depictions of heterosexual desire, and characters who fail to express heterosexual desire. Dennis also considers moments in which characters brush up against the potential for homosexual desire. In the issue Verse Than Ever, in the Betty and Veronica series, Veronica is aware that she is a character in a comic book and objects to its title, Betty and Veronica. She wants to be first. She argues that Betty would be better in last place because so many words rhyme with Betty that they could therefore create poems. As an example, she recites, "Break out the confetti, Veronica and Betty are going steady." Betty snarls, "Watch it." The exclamation point after going steady denotes that Veronica was finished with her rhyme that she had intended as a couplet. But with a look of sophisticated smugness, she adds a heterosexualizing coda with Freddie and Teddy. This moment registers the way in which characters are uncomfortable with queerness by presenting a potentially queer coupling between Veronica and Betty, followed by Betty's immediate rejection of it, before ultimately resolving the couplet with the heterosexual coda. Although Dennis treats Jughead's disinterest in women as a failure of heterosexuality, other scholars have more explicitly analyzed Jughead's asexuality as a positive identity formation. Archie Comics confirmed that Jughead's sexuality in the fourth issue of its 2017 run. In this issue, Kevin Keller tells Jughead, "Look, there are only like 5 gay guys at Riverdale High. My romantic options can't take that kind of hit. You just don't get it because you're asexual." Jughead then responds, "Yeah, well, it's why I can think clearly and see this administration for what it is. I'm not hobbled by these hormonal impulses." Jughead does not see himself as failing to live up to heterosexual norms, but rather as a triumph over hormonal impulses. As Nat Rell argues, when we understand Jughead as ace, he becomes the smart one in comparison to Archie's overly superficial concerns. Most of Archie's problems stem from his obsession with girls. And since Jughead has risen beyond such petty issues, he is able to focus on more important matters. Jughead clearly doesn't view himself as a failure of heterosexuality. Rather, he sees his asexuality as giving him an advantage. He's not distracted by romantic interests. Rell continues, additionally, his interactions with Ethel are reversed. The traditional understanding of such stories might cast Jughead as a failed heterosexual who cannot understand when someone is interested in him. However, when Jughead is read as asexual, this makes Ethel, not Jughead, the one who is misinterpreting the relationship, or lack thereof, between them. So, why is it important to have representation of ace characters in comics? Rell argues that representation of ace characters is important, especially for younger audiences, because, quote, people who do not fall within heteronormative standards often have a difficult time figuring out their identity when they are young, and a major factor in this difficulty is a lack of representation. If people are aware that there are others like them, even if those others are in the form of fictional characters, they are less likely to feel like they are alone or broken in some way. Therefore, acknowledgement that Jughead is ace is important not only to discourse about asexuality, but also to increasing the general public's understanding of asexuality and helping those who are ace in their effort to figure out their identity, end quote. Jughead is still one of the only handful of ace characters in mainstream media. Archie Comics' confirmation of Jughead as ace is a progressive move and an important step for media representation of ace characters. Comic studies is a diverse area of interdisciplinary research that I have only scratched the surface of here. Comics and graphic narratives have become an important lens to understand and analyze culture, history, disability, global issues, and much more. Research on Archie in particular has shown that the way comics can be used as a great instructional tool for literacy development. Further, scholarship on sexuality and gender has demonstrated that Archie is a rich resource of material. Comic studies has been around for over 20 years, but is still relatively new and will continue to grow and change the ways that scholars do research. Thank you.